Breaking Bad is, on the surface, the story of a modest, somewhat hapless family man who receives a terminal diagnosis of lung cancer. He has a wife, a 16-year-old son with cerebral palsy, and another baby is on the way. He works as an overqualified, highly underpaid, high school chemistry teacher by day and a car wash attendant by night. He's terrified that his wife will be left not only to raise their two children on her own, but will not have the money to do it. As such, Walter White begrudgingly starts employing his extensive chemistry training in a more lucrative sector, the production and distribution of crystal meth. In Breaking Bad, we see one of the most radical personality transformations we have ever seen, or at least so it seems. Who really was Walter White? And what can academic psychology tell us about why we perceived him the way that we did? In psychology, anchoring is a type of cognitive bias wherein a person's decisions are influenced by a particular point of reference, the anchor. Anchoring is used extensively in all sorts of negotiations for things like salary, price, criminal sentencing, and so forth. What Donald Trump referred to as the big ask played on the anchoring effect. You start off by asking for more than what you think you could reasonably expect to get, and then you negotiate down to what you actually want. The big ask makes the person that you're negotiating with compare your counteroffers to your initial offer, thereby making the new offer seem more reasonable than it would have seemed had it been presented first. A major kind of anchor is the first impression. First impressions serve as a sort of anchor or filter through which you interpret a person's subsequent actions. The anchoring effect of the first impression plays up huge in Breaking Bad. To see this, let's go back in time. When Breaking Bad launched, the last time that any of us had seen Bryan Cranston, who plays Walter White, was when he was the hapless, humble, quirky, good-natured dad on Malcolm in the Middle.
Who wants to make $5?
How?
I need someone to take the fall.
Oh my God.
What did you do?
I can't tell you. Yes or no, no questions asked.
Oh my God!
Make it 10.
Done.
Oh my God!
You're a good son. I got him, honey! I got him, don't worry!
And this is pretty much how Walter White started off in Breaking Bad, as seen in these clips from the very first episode.
Surprise! Happy birthday, Dad!
Oh, you're so very late.
When you're gonna bring a gun, baby, you gotta bring enough gun. 40 cal.
This is awesome right here.
Nice, isn't it?
Yeah. Dad, come check this out.
Yeah, see it.
Come on, take it.
Check it out, Walt. No, it's just heavy.
That's why they hire men.
Hey, it's not gonna bite you, all right? Looks like Keith Richards with a glass of warm milk, huh? Walt, just say the word and I'll take you on a ride along. You can watch us knock down a meth lab. Get a little excitement in your life.
Yeah, someday.
This starting point establishes a strong first impression that the Walter White character is a somewhat hapless but ultimately good person and family man. He doesn't usually do wrong, but when he does it for at least somewhat wholesome reasons, trying to help out or live up to an obligation to family members. As such, we are charitable to him when he blackmails Jesse Pinkman into partnering with him to produce meth.
But you know the business. And I know the chemistry. I'm thinking maybe you and I could partner up.
You want to cook crystal meth? And me.
That's right.
Wow.
Either that, or I turn you in.
As Walter begins his foray into the world of meth, he is clearly morally conflicted about it. This further confirms our positive first impression, making the anchor that much stronger. But Walter wouldn't stop there. Just 5 episodes later, this happened.
Making money. Why can't you just be satisfied with the way
it is? Come on! Jesus! Just grow some fucking balls!
In this scene, Walter is applying very strong pressure to Jesse, his young partner that is already scared and only working with Walter because he has been blackmailed. And now Walter is pressuring him to take even bigger risks in order to achieve bigger payoffs. Now, even here, it's easy to be sympathetic to Walt. He's taking on a big risk and he needs a commensurate payoff to justify the risks he's taking. And also, to his knowledge, he only has so long to live and thus he only has so long to earn to provide for his family in the long run after he's gone. As the show proceeds, more and more events like this play out, where Walter will do something terrible, for example, set someone's car on fire, or let Jane choke to death as he watched. But even in these increasingly extreme cases, it wasn't difficult to have a level of sympathy for Walter. In the case of the car, Walter had spent a lifetime getting pushed around by assholes. Here, an asshole ticked him off on the wrong day. Walt had been turning over a new leaf since his diagnosis, wherein he wasn't going to put up with this sort of thing anymore. And so he took a sort of generalized asshole revenge on this singular, particular asshole. In the case of letting Jane die, he was doing that because he understandably believed that she was a mortally bad influence on Jesse. The allowing of Jane to die was one of those moments midway through the show where it became undeniably clear, however, Walter is not the same guy he was. He has changed, but even still, it's easy to attribute his change to his circumstances, not to him. He continued to develop along this trajectory until it became unmistakable that Walter White, as we knew him, was dead. As we see here.
Jesse, you asked me if I was in the meth business or the money business. Neither. I'm in the empire business.
And here?
There's more money here than we could spend in 10 lifetimes. Please tell me, how much is enough? How big does this pile have to be?
And here...
So let me clue you in. I am not in danger, Skyler. I am the danger. A guy opens his door and gets shot and you think that of me? No. I am the one who knocks.
And of course, here.
Say my name. Eisenberg. You're goddamn right.
Heisenberg wasn't just a pseudonym. It was an alter ego. In Jungian psychology, Heisenberg would be conceived of as Walter White's shadow self. To Jung, the shadow is the dark side of the mind, which we generally try to repress and hide from others. It's associated with things like unfettered envy, selfishness, rage, lust, and desire for power. But where did it come from? Where did Heisenberg come from? When I rewatched Breaking Bad, it occurred to me that Walter White broke bad much more quickly and easily than I had perceived the first time. Now, perhaps it was because I no longer only had my first impression anchor, but now also had my last impression anchor, as I knew where we were heading. As a result, instead of my interpretations only being pulled in one direction, they were now being counterbalanced by completely opposing anchors. The second time you watch, it's also easier to notice all of the indications of Walter White's sense of resentment. It starts only a few minutes into the very first episode. This is the scene in which Walter is exercising in a dark, dreary room on a rinky-dink stepper machine while staring blankly at a plaque on the wall bearing his name for conducting research that contributed to the awarding of a Nobel Prize. He's literally staring at the greatness that he could have attained, but did not. In this same episode, in the birthday party clip I showed earlier, you see his brother-in-law, Hank, repeatedly establish himself as being the alpha male of the family, with Walt being the lovable butt of jokes. As the show proceeded, Walt would eventually engage Hank in an unnecessary overt power struggle to the point where he insisted upon getting his own 16-year-old son vomit-inducingly drunk just to assert himself over Hank.
It's all stupid, but hey. Walt, what you doing there?
What does it look like I'm doing?
Kid's 16. You going for Father of the Year?
What are you looking at him for? We're celebrating.
Take a pass on that one if I were you, okay?
Think we've been bogarting this puppy long enough.
Hey! Bring the bottle back.
Sorry, buddy. No can do.
My son! My bottle, my house!
In my second time watching Breaking Bad, perhaps the first time it hit me that he, Walter White, was transitioning to evil very quickly and smoothly, was the gruesome fucking balls scene that I showed earlier. Walter essentially owned Jesse via blackmail, and now he's not just bullying him into cooking and selling meth with him, but he's telling him to up the stakes with no apparent sense of moral restraint. Yet nevertheless, thanks to his starting point, it was very easy during the first viewing to excuse this behavior pretty much completely. Why? Well, psychologically speaking, the explanation starts with an anchor and ends with what is called the fundamental attribution error. The fundamental attribution error pertains to how we perceive the actions of ourselves or those we like or are allied with versus how we perceive the actions of those that we view as outsiders. When we or someone that we feel connected to does something good, we tend to attribute it to their character. They did good because they are good. When we or someone that we like does something bad, however, we're more likely to attribute it to their circumstances, not to their character. So for example, if they're rude, we'll say, you know, they hadn't slept well that night, or they were in a rush, or the person that they were rude to had been badgering them, or they've had this exact conversation 17 times and they're getting rather tired of it, and so forth. But on the other hand, when someone that we view as an outsider does something bad, we attribute that to their character. We say they did bad because they are bad. And when they do something good, we minimize it by saying things like, even a broken clock is right twice a day, or it wasn't that good of a thing to do, or they only did it because others were watching, and so forth. Now that you know what it is, you will see the fundamental attribution error all over the place. All you have to do is look at politics or, you know, events in the culture war for a few minutes, and you will see it very quickly. Vince Gilligan capitalized on this well-known cognitive bias in developing the character of Walter White and his shadow, Heisenberg. We readily ascribed the bad behavior of Walter White to his circumstances, though we were far less charitable to Gustavo Fring, even before Gustavo slit Victor's throat. Meanwhile, when Gustavo acted kindly, we were far quicker to view the kindness as strategic rather than genuine, as compared to how we would interpret Walter White's strategic kindness. And this is the exact kind of thing that makes Breaking Bad so good and so rewatchable. Walter White, he's a one-man crash course on resentment, how it can develop through years of being walked all over while being a nice guy, and how it can be ignited in such a way that it turns the nice guy into a monster. The dividing line between good and evil absolutely ran straight down the heart of Walter White. So, let's wrap it up. To those who watched this show more than once and did not know where it was heading the first time they watched, what was your experience of watching it again? Did you have a similar experience as what I had, where in the second time through, it occurred to you that Walter broke bad much more quickly and easily than you perceived the first time? Let me know in the comments, and I will see you next time.